Good morning, everybody, and welcome. Our speaker this morning is the infamous Tim Alderton, sitting over there. He's a native of Brookville in Western Pennsylvania. Tim attended Penn State University and received a BS degree in 2002 in horticulture. He then interned at Callaway Gardens in Pine Mountain, Georgia. After that, he came to Raleigh in March of 2005 and worked at Plant Delights Nursery for almost a year. And then the next year, in January 2006, he came to NC State and began work at the J.C. Raulston Arboretum, where he's been ever since. Tim is on our board, the board of the chapter of the Rock Garden Society, and he's here today to tell us about a trip he took last year to Northwestern, Colorado, to Steamboat Springs to see the wildflowers there at the annual meeting. So please welcome Tim Alderton.
I like things dark. Get as much darkness in here as we can. As Bobby said, yes, the national meeting last year. Oh, I need to turn my mic on. As I turn it off.
It's too dark to see the buck.
Yeah. And it's blinking red. And green. What's it mean when it's blinking red, Chris?
Not good things.
If I don't have the, oh, there we go, go green. No, it's blinking red. It's probably battery time.
Yeah.
Okay. So, I'll go to the other mic for now.
There we go.
Oh. Okay. We'll wait a second then. How long are you going
to be? A couple seconds.
Speak from your bathroom.
It's cloudy for me.
Okay. As I just lost the mic. Anyways, it was in Steamboat Springs, like Bobby said. We started, it was centered at the, the Mountain, Colorado Mountain College is where we were at. It was a great big college. You know, there were five or six buildings. We stayed in the dorms there, which I think there was one dorm. Most of the people were there. There were a few other people who stayed at some of the hotels. But at the dorm, the first morning after we got there, I got up early as I was a couple hours ahead of Colorado time, and I walked around, and this was just the field above the college itself where the dorms were. It was full of Wyathia, which if any of you read my article that I had in the Trillium, I mentioned the Wyathia, which is one of the major wildflowers in June and early July out there. This massive fields of color. And this is all Wyathia. This was on the other side of the bridge from just above the college looking northwest. You can even see yellow up in here, it's just everywhere. But that was one of the most ubiquitous plant that we would see the whole time we were out there. So we'll start with that, that one there. But anyways, the trip, we went a few different places. If you're not familiar with Colorado, here's the nice rectangle of Colorado, very convenient. And then this is the little subset where we ended up doing most of the hikes and stuff around Steamboat. And if you read my article, it was going up at Colorado 131, which is run right through here. And Nancy DeBrava and I drove up through there, and I had Nancy, she was driving, and I was spotting, and I was saying, Nancy, stop, and we jumped out. So anyways, that is where that takes place. But continuing on from that, we had 2 days of formal hikes, and we had some spare time aside from that. On the 24th, and then again on the 26th, I had some spare time to do our first, go to the first area, which was Dumont Lake area, which we did that on our own. Nancy and I drove there, as well as Cindy Cromwell. And then that was on the 24th. And then Nancy and I picked up a couple other participants in the conference from various places around the world in the country. And we took them back to Dumont Lake because we were seeing some things that we hadn't seen on our individual hikes. See if I can get this back on now.
Put it on your button area.
Here, I'll have you put it on. I can't do it right. Blinded. But anyways, the second place we went, or my first formal hike, which was, I went on the difficult hikes. I was a young person. I got the Greenville Creek Mine hike, which was about 9 miles, actually, of a hike, if I remember right, 8 or 9 miles. The elevation change was from like 7,600 feet to about 8,500 feet. So there was a bit of change there. And we went up and then we went back down. Big long walk. It was wonderful. And then the third one was actually just on the edge of Steamboat itself. There's this canyon that kind of goes up through here. And that was the Fish Creek Falls hike. That was about a 4 or 5 mile hike, which there were some areas that were a little bit more steep than we were the previous day. But those are the three main areas. And as just a refresher again, where we're at, we're up in here.
What month were you
there? This was in June. This was June. The 3 days involved with this were June 24th, 25th, and 26th. So you'll see even some snow here. Actually, on our drive to Steamboat earlier on the 23rd, we did see snow flying in the central part of the state, but not anywhere near Steamboat. So anyways, these were my compadres for part of the trip here. Nancy was there around pretty much the whole time, except for she went on different hikes than me. And Cindy, we drug her along. This was her first experience going out botanizing. I had Nancy doing that beforehand, so other trips. So this was on our way to the Dumont Lake area, as I call it, which was along Colorado 40 near Rabbit Ear Pass, actually. So, but this was just outside of Steamboat. I saw something and I had to stop. And well, they went over and were looking out over a vista. I don't know if you can see the just a little bit behind those trees. This is looking out over the valley, and they were looking at that while I was looking at other things, and I got their picture. So,
what are those trees?
Those are aspens. Populus trembuloides, quaking aspens, which you'll see more pictures of those later on. But these were some really big ones. So, anyways, this was at our first stop, which was right along 40. Colorado 40. It was a big, wide open meadow, wet meadow actually, and Kappa septileptula here, septileptula, I can't spit it all out this morning. But the white marshmallow marigold was actually pretty common in these areas. You can actually see a little bit of yellow in here too. That's a species of ranunculus. I'm not going to talk about that one today. I like the Kappa or Kalfa a little bit more, but here's a close up of the Kalfa. Just thousands and thousands of these stretched out across these wet meadows that would probably, right now, they're probably under 3 or 4 feet of snow, if not more than that. The snow had just melted. Pardon? I'm doubting that we can grow these, because this is, this area here is about 9,500 to 9,600 feet, and I've seen it at well over 13,000, so I don't think it would like us. It might grow at this time of the year and quickly go dormant in 2 days, you know, when we have an 80-degree day. So anyways, continuing on. In this same area, there were some more open areas. It wasn't quite so wet, though. I did see a similar species of this in wet areas. This Androsaceae septraminalis. This is a little primrose relative, and those individual plants are about 2 inches tall. Minuscule little thing, adorable little things though. I had seen this for the first time when I was in Colorado in 2010 at about 12,500 feet or more than that actually, on the slopes of Mount Sherman. Yes, Mount Sherman. But anyways, but here it was growing in patches. Just the most adorable little thing you'll ever see. Primulaceae, like I said, would not grow here again. But this one, I don't know, we might be able to grow some of these orchids, but this is Plantanthera dilatata. So this is a scent bottle orchid. Happened to find this. This is in the same area. This is right at a seep, actually, that was right along the road. I saw these beautiful orchids were coming into flower. There's just one of them here. I saw some later on in some of the other hikes that I was on as well. I didn't know that it was called scent bottle at the time, and I didn't crouch down to smell it. I take pictures of things and then find out what they are later. I don't waste time. Come home and it's easier to find it online than to be flipping through a book out in the middle of nowhere. So anyways, now I did not smell it. As you can see, there's even dandelions growing there too. But and across the road, this is what actually brought me to stop at this, or had Cindy, who was driving at this point, stop at this spot, was I was seeing these yellow, oops, wrong button here. I'm seeing these yellow flowers here in the woods along the road. The Erythronium grandiflorums were just coming into flower in this area as the snow melted. I mean, you'd see just right at the edge of the snow, you'd see them, they would be an inch or so tall, and then it gradated up until they were in full flower. There'd be big patches of these throughout the woods. I don't know if you, did you guys see these anywhere?
Yes, we did.
You did? Okay. Because at lower elevations, these were totally done flowering. And here's a close-up of the blossoms. Most of them were like this. I've heard that they, some of them at times have different colored stamens, but all the ones I were seeing had a yellow stamen. And then I did manage to find a pastel yellow one, which was quite uncommon.
Why are they called avalanche lily? Do they grow in the...
Snow. I mean, they grow, as you saw in that picture, that first picture, there's still snow here. They would grow in areas where there's excessive amounts of snow. So avalanches, snow, that's why is, I'm assuming that they're called avalanche lilies. It would be like we call trout lilies.
Yes, we can grow
we can grow other trout lilies. These are about, almost some of them up to over about 10 to 12 inches tall. So these are way larger than our native trout lilies that you'll be seeing here probably by the end of the month. Actually, I should check outside my door at home. With this warm weather we've been having, they should be coming into blossom. Anyways, those are what brought me to a stop at this location. And right along the road, this was growing. This is a giant lupin, but you know, 4 inches tall at most. This Lupinus cespitosus, this stemless dwarf lupin. I actually saw it the second time we were there. We parked right in this spot the first time, and I did not notice. I walked right over top of it. Beautiful little thing, just hugging the ground, but right along the road in the gravel. In those disturbed areas, they did very well. And from there, we moved on. We went closer to Dumont Lake, which is actually right over here in this area. Here, there's a road right here, the lake's up here. This is one of the views looking east. I don't know what mountains those are. They're part of the Rockies, but we go over that direction later on our trip home. This would be the backside of the Front Range.
Yeah.
This is way west of the Front Range.
Yeah.
But anyways, just a few views. Yes, these were the three that we picked up on the 26th when we were done with our, they were on the hike I was at on the 26th. And they wanted to see the trout lily, or the glacier lily. So I said I knew where they were at because all we were seeing on our hikes were a little bit past. Let's just put it that way. I'll show you later on. But anyways, this is Gerard Van, I won't spit his name out. This is Gerard. He was from, I believe, the Netherlands in one of the botanic gardens over there. He spoke a few days later, actually, to the Rocky Mountain chapters of the Rock Garden Society for their meeting that month. Tony Resnicek, he's from Michigan. He is a botanist. He loves carrots. But he is very knowledgeable. You can't see him there. He's really in there. He's actually looking at the blue flowers, which you'll see here in the next slide, actually. And then Johan, he was one of our speakers. I think he's probably younger than me, but he is from, I think he was from Sweden, Utrecht, if I remember correctly. And I don't remember what Utrecht stands for, but it's one of the botanic gardens over there. He had spoken probably the night before, actually. But anyways, this is what Tony was looking at in that picture. And this is actually the 2 days prior when I got Cindy and Nancy. They were not gonna get out of the car at that location. They were just standing. I went out and I said, you guys have to come here and see these Mertensiana that were in flower all over. And this is this close up on them, one of them, the Mertensiana umbilicifolia. These were only maybe 6 inches tall. I think this is what it is anyways. There's 5 or 6 different species. Some of them are delineated by the length of the style. Others, there are some grouping based on height as well. But there's the small species two or three small species and two or three larger growing species. So my best guess is a longifolia. Most of them were this shade, but then we did manage to find this pastel blue with a white center in it as well. And then this was, I think, Hortensiana ciliata, which we had seen at the previous location, but there were some really nice clumps here near Dumont Lake as well. These were about 18 to 20 inches tall. So, I mean, they were probably that, you know, almost up over my knee easily. Most of them were blue. Here's a close-up of the flowers as they're opening. But there was one, this was totally just this pastel purple or lavender kind of shade, shaded one, which was actually at the base of the dam for Dumont Lake. This was one of Cindy's favorites. And this was the first day we were there, when Cindy was there. This is Veratrum californicum. It was just everywhere. They were just emerging. These, I don't know how many weeks these would have been out of the ground, but they just the texture of the foliage on this was really great. They don't flower every year, and they actually aren't that pretty when they flower. They kind of look like a corn tassel stuck on top of them when they're in flower. But the foliage is the reason enough to grow these. But a few days later, these looked totally different. They were already 6 or 8 inches taller and way more expanded out. And it wasn't as impressive to me. But
why is it called a false hellebore?
I'm not quite sure.
It doesn't look anything like
it. It does not. But common names, that's why I don't use them. It might be poisonous like a hellebore too. I don't know. I didn't look that up. We have species here in the eastern United States as well, but this is the californicum. And they were even sort of split it out into another species, but I was going with the accepted name. So. Oh, and this is above Dumont Lake is Rabbit Ear Peak, which we were driving towards Rabbit Ear Pass. So I thought that was a good picture there. And Nancy, the couple days later, did get her picture taken in front of that with rabbit ears on her head. But I told her I wouldn't put that in the presentation. So,
that peak is,
I think, what I have 10,650 some feet or something like that, high there. So we're down a couple hundred feet lower than that, anyway. So, or yeah, not almost 1,000 feet lower. And in the meadows that were around there, there were a bunch of things. And I think this one's funny. You're saying about hellebore. I think this one's funny. I never saw these in the woodland. Woodland star. This is a lithophragma glabrum, which is the baldest woodland star. Later on, we'll see another species, and I'll show you some differences in that. But I don't know if you can see them, but there's little knobs right here, and you can't see them in this picture quite so much. But down here, there's some. These are the little where the bulbils are, and here's some much more visible ones. Which that's how it propagates itself, I guess, is one way anyways. I think these are in the Saxifragaceae, so the Heuchera family, another saxifrage family, plants in that family. But they were growing in an open meadow there. This one had much more cut petals than the one we'll see later on.
Tim,
here's the part of the lake, actually. Yes?
What's the temperature range at this time of year?
It was in the 70s when we were there, but on our last day in the morning, it might have been the 26th, 27th, I forget which day, it would have been the 27th, we went to Mike Kinchin's high elevation garden, his parents, which was another about 20 miles north of where we were at, and he had frost, so on the 27th of June. And you can still see there's snow here. It was very pleasant when we were there. Wonderful. And then we got back to Denver and it was in the low 90s again. But this is the day Cindy was here. Cindy, I'm glad you weren't with us the next day. It was like there were bugs everywhere. They weren't biting, but there were just millions and millions of bugs. I don't know if they were midges or what, but they were just flying everywhere. You didn't dare open your mouth. But it was wonderful the day we were there. And this was just 2 days prior. But along that lake, there were some shrubby ribes, laxiflora, and this trailing black currant, and the flowers in this are just beautiful. The western currants are gorgeous, the ribes. We can't grow them here. They don't like us out here. I've killed some other ones here in the garden. And they also, they don't like you planting a lot of ribes anyways sometimes because they also carry a or a carrier for a rust that white pine gets. But not that
so
that's a major issue.
So these are edible
here.
Then?
I would, yeah, they would be edible whenever they would set fruit. Yeah. Oh, and here's Cindy, proving she was there. this is actually, that other picture was probably over in here. And there was a path right along the lake here. And one little clump of Polemonium foliosissimum. And that's the best I can figure out of what it is, because there were a couple other species, but none that were blue. Because this one's not very towering. This is a close-up. The 2 days later, I brought the Johan, Tony, and Gerard here, and there was actually a fisherman sitting about 5 or 6 feet from this, and I'm bringing them down there, and we're all huddled. There are three guys huddled with another one standing there, taking photos of that little Polemonium. I thought was kind of funny. He probably thought, what in the world? Another relative, the Polemonium is in the phlox family, the Polemoniaceae, or the Jacob's Ladder family, for that matter. This is another plant in that same family, this Leptosiphon on the Talii. We saw this actually at the Botanic Garden, the branch of the Botanic Garden. I can't think of what's right now. Pardon? Chatfield. At Chatfield, we saw these. I couldn't find the label there. I couldn't find the label here either. I had to figure this out. These were just coming into flower here on top of the meadow there as well. So beautiful little flower. And we drove the road that went to Dumont Lake. It used to make a full loop, but it dead ended. And where at the dead end, we stopped and we actually took some pictures of these delphinium that were in full flower, big swaths of them. This Delphinium Italian. They were only about a foot or so tall. Just gorgeous blue were the most of them, but there was one pure white, or pure pink one here. 2 days later, I did see some white ones, but they were at lower elevations. They weren't as pristine as these. They were a bit past on the Fish Creek hike. So. And another plant that we saw at the same, just with these delphinium, actually, was this Hydrophyllum capitatum water leaf. We have water leaves actually out in the mountain. There's probably some here in this area too. But they were just in full flower. There were just a handful of them. But I came back 2 days later and they were about done. So they're very fleeting on how long they flower. Oh, no, I still have a few more here before we get to the next location. But. And also back in those wet meadows, we would see a few of these Trawlus laxus, subspecies Elvifloris, spit all that out, the American globe flower. That was a really nice big clump, but it was a little bit past. But here was one that was basically pristine. And those were a couple inches wide. These would be growing with the caltha that we saw there earlier on, but they were much taller. They were over a foot tall, maybe a foot and a half. And the foliage is totally different on these, so you could distinguish between them, but they're closely related, all in the Ranunculaceae. And at the base of the dam there were a couple species of Pedicularis. This is Bracteosa, which is a yellow-flowered species, which it can get up to about 3 feet tall. Not the most attractive one, but this Bract allows for it. But I only saw a few of these there. They're in a group of plants that are closer related to the paintbrushes, the Indian paintbrushes, the Orobranchaceae, and I can't remember. I think these are not parasitic, but most of that family is parasitic or hemiparasitic characteristics. We did see another one, another species there. They weren't quite open at this location, this Pedicularis groenlandica, elephant heads, lousewort. But when Nancy and I were on our way back to Denver on the 27th, we did go a different route than what we came, and we found a whole bunch of them. I saw them in a couple spots, but we found a spot that we could pull over, and there was a hay field that was being irrigated, and it was posted, but I still went in. This was the whole field of them that were in full flower. Nancy didn't go out in there, but But anyways, this was about 8 or 10 miles southeast of where we were just at, actually. So that was the end of the that section, the Dumont Lake area. And this is my first true hike that we went on, was the Greenville Creek Mine hike. And again, this one was about an 8 or 9 mile hike, 7,600 to about 8,500 feet elevation. And we did go this way and this way up this hillside to get to places. And we passed one of the mine heads here, which were no longer being used, of course. But, and that, this is one of them. And it was, this was on the west side of the slope. So this is in the morning. The light hadn't got here. So the light, some of these early pictures are a little blurry because the light wasn't quite as good as I'd like. One along one of the paths, not too far from that mine head itself, was the Gallardia aristata. So the blanket flowers, which I typically think of, the ones I always see anyways, or grew from seed, always had the red bars on them in the inside. But this, the ones I was seeing in this area, when I did see them, were always the pure yellow form, no bars on there. First time I had really gotten to see them like that. I would grow that one in my garden. We can grow these in our garden, so this is one of those you can actually grow here. Not too far from that, the Antenaria rosea. I had seen other species of Antenaria. I don't, distinguishing them, it's a little bit of a challenge. I think you have to have a degree just to do the Antenarias, the pussy toads. The pink rosea, it stands out. So it was not hard. We had seen it actually the day before as well, near Dumont Lake. Here's a little bit closer up, and again, it's not as clear as I'd like because of low light levels we had that day, but on that side of the mountain. This is one I really like, the Ipomoxus aggregatus. And as you can see, this is, it's called Scarlet Gillian. The typical form of this is red. And coming up 131, most everything we were seeing was red. But in this area in Rout County, everything I was seeing was white, or there were a few pink ones. This pristine white, though, just in the morning, it just stood out beautifully. Those were about 2 to 3 feet tall. We do have a native species out here in the east, which is, I think, coccinia. But you don't see it very often. But out there, you see quite a few different Ipomopsis. And again, that's in the phlox family, so or Polymoniaceae, Jacob's ladder family. Continuing up the slope, we managed to see some actually flowering Balsema rhiza sagittata. I hadn't seen this in flower at lower elevations. They were already finished flowering. All you'd see is the foliage. It kind of looks like if anybody has grown Rudbeckia maxima, the blue foliage of that, but only about a plant that only gets 2 feet tall. Flower stalks don't get 8 feet tall like on that. And it flowers first thing in the spring. They were a little bit past, but those were the nicest clumps I found. Okay, so we've reached the top, and you get these extreme differences in moisture just on from one little spot to the next. And this was an open, sunny area, very gravelly soil, and there were all kinds of things growing there, but this is one that I actually pulled to put in here. This is the Ficeria acutifolia. It was done flowering right here. These are the seed pods now, but I love the rosettes of the foliage. Almost give the appearance of a really loose hens and chick or an echevera. But these would have been yellow flowers probably just a couple weeks before that, and then the pods form, which they swell, and they're two-sided, and that's where the twin pod comes in. So we ventured on, like I said, it transitioned very quickly from wet, dry. And this area, I was looking, and I remember Mike Kinchin, I think, has actually told us that Rout County is one of the wettest areas of Colorado, but there's this gradient, anywhere from about 25 inches to 55 inches of rain, just on this very tight swath, right in the area we were at. So you get these really extreme variations in plants just over a very short area. But anyways, this was going back in the woodland where it was much moister and shadier. This is Fraseria speciosa, the elkweed. I saw this when I was in New Mexico in 2015. And I remember seeing lots of this on Mount, or in Weston Pass in central Colorado in 2010. They were in flower then. This is the rosettes, which this is up about, it's probably a good 15 inches tall by 20 inches wide. It's a good sized plant. Looks about like a hosta. This is an agenchinaceae. Originally, they thought these things were biennial, and that you get these big rosettes and then they flower. But they've done research now, and they've realized that they live a little bit longer than 2 years, maybe 20 to 80 years. And they are monocarpic. So they're kind of like the agave of, or the century plant of the agenchinaceae. In 2010, when I was out in Colorado for the first time, like I said, at Weston Pass, there were masses of them in flower. And this is the an inflorescence that was about 3 feet tall, and the green flowers. Another name for the, a common name for these are monument plants. So, and I think that's pretty apparent why they called it monument plant. But they were all over this hillside here on the Weston Pass. Back to Greenville Mine. Our Greenville Creek mine area. This is again up on top of the ridge. We come out of the woods again. We're back on the ridge. This is on the east side of that ridge. And this was our crew for that day, basically, aside from the guy who was taking the photo on my camera, I won't get into that, but he's a really good photographer and videographer. But anyways, we stopped to take a short break, get a drink, maybe eat a snack. Before we continued on, but you're looking, this is east of us over here, and there's just beautiful vistas wherever you looked. But up here on top of this area, we found this Collinia linearis. This is another phlox relative. I think they have so many different plants in the Polyboniaceae out there that we don't have out here, or at least I don't realize that we have out here. But this is just a tiny little pink flowered plant. Which I realized later on, looking back through my pictures, I had seen it at one of the last stops that Nancy and I took on 131. So it was growing among some other things. But this was up there on top of that ridge. It was just flowering its head off. And again, like I said, back into the woods. We were going to cross back across this ridge, again to the west side of the ridge. And we came to this beautiful aspen grove. These colonies of clonal colonies of aspen are just spectacular with the trunks, and I have several pictures just scattered throughout here just because I like them. So this is one. Emerging out on the other side again, we've got more sun again. Very different situation from that forest. This is very dry. You've got the balsam arising here, and we also have the flax, the Linum luisii, which is the species that's out there. Beautiful clear blue blossoms on there. Here's a close-up of that. Looking a little bit southwest here. And this will be off to the side, I think, of the next picture that I'm going to show here. That mountain's right here, or that hill was right here. The two of you would remember, what was the name of the town? Clark. Clark, the little Clark store is right here. So this is a reference thing. We came up, there's a road right here, we came up over here, through the ridge over here. And we came out across this ridge that parallels Clark. But this next picture, this is from right here, basically. So looking up, this was the on our way back after visiting Mike Kimson's garden. But keep an eye on this little tree here. That's a limber pine there, and there's actually a juniper right beside it, which we'll see in the next slide, which you can use that for reference. We walked across this ridge here. And I didn't realize at the time, but there was a photo bombing mule deer right here. Anyways, back on top of that ridge. This is that pine I pointed out, and there was a juniper right next to it, which I knew was there. We walked across that ridge. So anyways, just for pretty view and some reference.
Tim, what about the land ownership?
This, I think, was all public land. Bottom of this, there was some grazing in fenced-in areas, but looking at the maps, these were all blocked in green. as being public land. So this is what we could lose if...
But the free range, you know, that there's so much controversy.
This was free range, because later on there were areas where we saw cow pies in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah.
coming across that, right over in here, there is a dry hill bank here, and this is where we saw these campanulata rotundifolia, the bluebell bellflowers, which this is a really widely distributed species, apparently. I looked it up, and it's like, of the lower 48, there's only the southeastern United States and Kentucky or something. Don't have it recorded, but I've seen this several times. Beautiful little campanula, though. Rounding that ridge again, we're starting back down. This is onto the east side of that ridge. We came around the end of it. And we had seen these before, the ceanothus volutinus. And this is what actually originally had me stop, I think, for that first picture with Cindy and Nancy, was to look at some of this that was on a bank on the adjacent side of the road. This is the ceanothus volutinus. You might know them as California lilacs or wild lilacs when you see the blue-flowered species out in the western United States. There's one species out here in the east does not flower quite like this. And these were spectacular, just covered in beautiful white flowers, full flower at that time. Low shrubs, probably maxing out about 4 to 5 feet, but just covered in white blossoms. There was a light fragrance too. It's not like a lilac fragrance, but it has a light fragrance, not unpleasant though. And near there, we were also seeing some of the rubus parviflorus, which this is actually from when we first got there on the opposite side of the ridge where we parked our vehicle. But this is not the best picture, but I never took a better one of the whole plant, unfortunately. But this is one of the thimbleberry. So this is like a raspberry, big maple-like leaves. And you can see some of the white flowers here. I did get a close-up going down that adjacent to those ceanothus, actually. Big 2-inch flowers anyways on those. To go along with those big maple like leaves. Just really pretty and very different. It had very fine prickles if it had it, not the big spines that our raspberries have out here in blackberries. So, not overly dangerous. But we went back into the woods after that. We came down the side of that ridge and we were going back down in elevation, and we came into the woods and we started looking for some orchids, actually. And this is let's see if I can spit it out. Corolla rhiza maculata, the summer coral root. This is a totally parasitic, or it has an association, whichever, with fungi. There are several species of these throughout the United States, and I ended up seeing two on this trip, and this is the most common here. About 12 to 15 inches tall. And from what I understand, they have no real roots. They just have this rhizome, and they steal stuff from the fungi. But anyways, really interesting flowers on that orchid. And in the woods, we were also seeing a white species of geranium, this Geranium richardsonii. There you were seeing a whole bunch of it. There's a close-up of the flowers, just pristine white flowers with just a little bit of lines on them. Later on, we'll see another species, which you typically would see in open grassy areas or fields and prairies in a different color. And coming through the woods here, this is just for any of you who have been out there, you probably saw lots of dead trees. It's a life cycle out there. This is mountain pine beetle damage. On the trees that get such an age, basically, it's the cycle is they grow to an age and either get burnt or they get pine beetle, and they die. So this is one you can see the pine beetle actually damaged on this one. It was a good sized tree, so it's the limber pine, Pinus contorta. So, and you can see in this picture here, actually all the Pinus contorta here that had succumbed to the pine beetle, because there hadn't been a fire or a blow. But anyways, this is like what I showed you. The first picture I showed you was Wyatheia plexicaulis. So we're going back to that plant again here. We came out of that woods again, and there's another slope. This goes down to a stream. This is very dry, sunny slope, covered in wildflowers, which typically I had seen in much moister situations. Here it was growing in a rather sunny area, and it was a bit more sparse. As you get down here, it became much more prolific. And keep an eye on these little white flowers here. I'll show you that one here in a minute. But here's a close-up to that same location, looking across the hillside of the Wayathia. The next, those little white flowers, this Phlox multiflora, you could smell these just near. You don't even have to get down on the ground. They're like our creeping phlox that we have out here in the eastern United States. But very fragrant little flowers. You'd see them in grassy areas sometimes along the roads, but this was on that hillside. And there were occasionally some that had some pink tones to them. Typically, though, they were pure white. Not that species, no. We can grow, a good substitute for that would be subulata, the creeping phlox. And earlier I showed you the pure white form of the Ipomopsis aggregata, and this, there was a really nice specimen of one of the pink flowered forms. So, just included that. In Clematis hirsutissima, actually there's one, right through the wall, right under here. it never does what they look like out there. You get big clumps of them out there. We get two flower stalks if we're lucky. But you can see the phlox in the background. This was a late flowering one. Most of them were already done flowering, and you saw the tufts of the seed heads instead. But we had seen this here and then on our drive up, and we would see it the following day after this. At the bottom of that hill, I mean, it was a steep hill. If it was like this, there was a stream running. And there were some wet areas. And this was another of the Primulaceae. I showed you Androsaceae septrema something or other. I can't spit it out without looking at it right now. If you look there, it's like the second or third plant earlier. This is another species. A little taller growing. It was about 4 inches tall, but on these really wiry inflorescence. Taller stems, but it looks like almost like an allium or a little fireworks coming up out of that plant. This was growing right in the mud along a seep that went down into the stream then. The Androsaceae filiformis. And I also showed you another species of these earlier, the lithophragma. I don't remember, was it glabrum or something like that? I can't remember, but anyways, this is part of Flora. Petals on this one are a little bit more rounded. It's supposedly the small flower one. If you notice, the first one I showed you, they had little bulbs down here. There's no bulbs forming on the flower stalk at the base of where the flowers were. And penstems, which most of the penstems out there are blue. And it's a pain figuring out some of these blue ones when they all look alike, but there's some that don't look alike. But anyways, this is one of the exceptions out there. This was Penstemon whipleanus, which there's a couple different forms. And this is the form I was most familiar with. These plum-colored ones. I really love this color. I wish these were grow forests, but they don't. But we saw some of these on this hike here. The next day, see the other form, which I had never seen before. But anyways, Penstemon whipleanus, this was growing on just above the stream. It wasn't a wet area, it was on the slope, but not where I see some of its relatives later on. In the really wet areas, you see Dodecatheon plocellum, or Primula plocellum probably now. Primulaceae, again, this is not a great photo, but showing some of the more of a mass of them. Here's a much better one. This is the floral emblem for the Rocky Mountain chapter, so nards. And up again on the bank, I managed to find Crudulus aria, which it's not recorded for Ralph County, which is where this was at. So it took me a little bit of time to figure this one out. Growing just one clump of it. So looks kind of like lutea, which you can sometimes get to grow out here, which is a European species. And you can see all the seeds here. This is probably getting ready to go to sleep already for the year, is my guess. Being it's
starting to elongate quite a bit. I don't think it would last much longer in the heat. And just down from that, beautiful hillside, dry hillside, all kinds of things in here. I'll talk about some of these other things later on, but the key thing we're going to talk about from this little area here is all that blue that you're seeing there. There's a penstone strictus. Like I said, there were all kinds of penstones. This is the only one I can truly identify, and sometimes they were saying, oh, it might not be that, it might be some other species. They're always trying to find another species of penstone out there, I think. Colorado and Utah fight for the most species of penstone. So, but as far as I can tell, these are strictus. They typically have all the flowers on one side. We did for a time have some of them down here in the Xeric garden. They lasted 4 or 5 years. So this is one worth trying, actually, here. That's the typical form, but we managed in this spot to find a few pure white, which our hike leader said she's never seen a pure white one. And here's some close ups of that. And there was also a pink one, which the exceptions to the rule here for a flower that's typically blue. So, but this penstone strictus, wide distribution in the western United States, but always spectacular when you see them. In the same spot, there was also Delphinium occidentale, which is a naturally occurring hybrid. In Route County. I don't think this one is listed for Route County, but this one is. I've seen this one before, but we didn't see it that day. So I don't know how you get the hybrid whenever you don't have both parents there, but it must have come across by a bird. But anyways, this bicolor form of Delphinium right here. And that was probably 2.5-3 feet tall, if I remember. Well, those Delphinium I showed you earlier were only about a foot tall, maybe 15 inches. From that beautiful dry hillside, you got to the bottom of the hill and it was moist, and you get into these moist meadows again. We got some Geum triflorum, was in full flower. Here, I'm going to use that just to show you, just big patches of it, not dense. It's called a prairie smoke because when they actually go to seed, I don't have any pictures of that. The inflorescence, it gets these really filamentous fibers coming off of it, and it gives it a smoke-like look. So, but here's a close-up of the flowers right there. It doesn't have the orange or yellow flowers that typically think of GM, but this one was also one we saw in Michigan. They had them growing there as well. And this is the other geranium I was saying that we'd see. This is one you'd see in more open, sunny areas than Richardsonii, which was a woodland species. You've got different shades of pinks and light shades, and there's some dark ones here. But this is one I could try. I really like what I got with the longhorn beetle on here. And then when you really got down on the ground, this one was tiny. These are like 2 inches tall like that. This Montia, and I'm not quite sure how to say that. So this water minor lettuce here, which this is in the Portulacaceae, closely related to and once included in the genus Claytonia, which would be our spring beauties. I think these are annual though, instead of being perennial. But these were hiding among the grass. You'd see some white, and it was actually these little minor lettuce. So you could probably get a snack if we had needed them at that point, but we didn't. And I had to include this. You saw these here and there everywhere. This is state flower of Colorado, of course, but this was just a particularly nice clump of them. This Aquilegia cerulea of the Colorado blue columbine. And if I had taken the picture the other way, there was actually, you looked off in the distance and there were the mountains in the background. Just across the path from that, we're actually turning our way back around. We're coming up the south side of this ridge now that we originally came around. Went north and came back around, making a big loop. This was a Sorbus scopulina, or a mountain ash. We don't do mountain ash very well here. There are a couple species in the western part of North Carolina, but this is one, it's a western species out there. Rather shrubby, maybe 8 to 10 feet tall, and at that time of the year, you got these fluffy white inflorescence. It would have been followed by probably orange fruit or red fruit that you'd see like on pyracantha or on other mountain ash. But it was a bit too early for that. So from there, we continued down. Like I said, this is, we're wrapping back around. We met up kind of with a ravine that followed the Greenville Creek itself. And on one of the, hiding along one of the banks was this clematis. This is the only one I saw these the whole time. It's actually senescing. The petals were already, or the sepals, I should say, were already falling off of it. This clematis occidentalis variety, Grassa serrata, the western blue virgin bower. Oh, and our hike leader, I didn't point her out in that group of photo group that we did earlier on, but this is Karen Vale, who was our hike leader, and is very knowledgeable about the plant material there. And if you want to know where to go to hike, she's an excellent reference. But for Cindy, here's your Virach from California coming in here. Let's see, Karen is probably about this tall. So those Virachrum are probably about that tall at this point. And there were some that were flowering in these bunches here. But this is just in a wet area going down through the woods, and you see the aspen here. And then there were also fir and spruce trees and pine as well in different locations, but very moist area. And as you can see, here's the stream here. This is the Greenville Creek here. We're looking at this plant though, this Streptopus and plexifolius. This would be closely related to Solomon's seals and disporums. So your fairy bells, I think, and uvularia would be another thing they're closely related to. They were in flower, and here's some of the blossoms right here. Not the most spectacular, but hiding in there. But those plants were, you know, they were waist high. It was kind of nice seeing those. Okay, and that ended our Greenville Creek section. And this is the last section here. This Fish Creek Falls hike, which we kind of did a U. We didn't make a complete circle here. They dropped us off in one spot and they picked us up in another, but where they dropped us off at the parking lot, there was this sign here, and I wish I'd seen a moose that time. I saw one when I was in Colorado my first time in 2010, but it was way, way over. And since then, I've been seeing pictures on Facebook by the one guy who was on this hike with me, who lives there. He's posting that they're walking down through the village of Steamboat, and, or they're right outside the Botanic Garden, outside the gate. Yeah. They have to close the gate to keep them out. But anyways, we didn't get to see any, and they are dangerous if you do see them, so you have to be a little bit cautious. Anyways, we'll start that hike here. Just along off the parking lot was Lonicera involucrata. This one you can grow as much for the flower, which is kind of a yellowy orange flower, which you don't see here. I've seen it in the wild in Oregon and California, and also in New Mexico on the Sangre de Cristo mountains. But this was already in fruit, and actually it saw 2 days earlier on our way to Mount Evans. But, the bracts that surround the fruit are really nice. Two flowers in here, but I just happened to see that along the pathway. It only gets a couple feet tall most of the time in this area, though in Oregon and Washington I did see it when it was probably 6 or 8 feet tall. Probably 2 to 3 feet here. Probably the moose eating it. But same place. Whereas this Aconitum columbianum, the Colombian monk's hood, just a couple of these in flower here. I saw them in a wet meadow when we were on our drive up, the last place that we stopped before I had to realize what time it was and we needed to get this to Steamboat. But this is when I actually had a good chance to get several photos of and get right up to it. Taking a tight path, I mean, this path is not much more than a foot and a half wide. Getting some pictures of these was somewhat difficult, but Richard crouched down like this, and you have people all around you. And I just lost my mic. this is Pyrolia azarifolia. So I guess it would be a pyrolia that looks kind of like an acerum. But the
the round leaves. And you might know one of its cousins, Pipsissewa, is what I call them here. We have them native. And we'll see another one which is in the same genus as this later on. But this is in the same family as that. And this, like I said, it was difficult getting pictures of these. And this is a bit blurry, but that was the best one I got of an open flower whenever it's down on the ground and you're crouching to do it. Anyways. One more. There we go. Coming out of the woods, which we had been down. That's the right button. We were down in here, in these aspen, actually, is where we were seeing that pyrolia there, that last one. You come out, and then there's another rock outcropping. And again, very different flora in this area. The plant that we were looking for here, we did eventually find. There was one plant we were really looking for here, but I'll show you just one other thing here in a second. But again, I just love the white trunks of the aspen. Mm-hmm. To highlight, but this was Heterotheca villosa. I like Heterotheca. I've now seen it. I saw a lot of it in New Mexico, and we saw it on our drive. Excuse me, here in Colorado. We had another species up on the roof, but it finally fizzled. The Jonesy Eye, a little one, but this is villosa. It gets about 10 inches tall, and it forms little bushes. Flowers the entire summer out there, but. Growing in terribly dry, rocky conditions, or it'll grow in better conditions than that too. But this would be one worth trying growing here, actually. But that was growing, as you can see, just out of this rock. But we managed to find, after about 25 minutes of us, of 15 people looking around, we found this plant. It was done flowering, but this is the seed head of Fritillaria atropurpurea. That was why we stopped at this location, because it's one of the few places that Karen knew that she had been able to find it anyways, locally. So. And I just thought this was kind of interesting. Maianthemum stellatum here. We have Maianthemum racemosum, or what's the old name now? Smilacina racemosum. This is growing on a rock. And this is, I think, selaginella here that has all dried up. It's probably just growing in 2 to 3 inches of soil there. And you don't think of Maianthemums growing as a rock garden plant or on a rock. I just thought that was really strange that you'd see other things like that later on. This is that penstrom I had seen the day before that I said that was plum colored. And showed you the plum-colored one. But there was another form I'd never seen before. This is the yellow or white form, whatever I've heard it called different, both while we were there, of Penstrom woodleianus. And saw these growing more in the woods. I've always seen the purple form or the plum-colored form more in sunny areas. And here, this is the next of him. Let's see if I can spit this out. Schimophila umbellata, subspecies occidentalis. We have Schimophila maculata here, which is our species of Pipsissewa. This is the one they have out there, which doesn't have the silver on the foliage, but it has little pink flowers and flower buds. So. Also, growing the shadiest spots that you can't get in your photo. Ferns. There were actually quite a few ferns out there, but I only took. It only included one of them in here, but this is Cryptogramme arctostroides, American crane break, or rock break, I should say. This was growing in a shady spot, but later on that same day, I saw this coming out of just a rock crevice, it was just a hole in the rock in full sun, and it was doing perfectly fine. So very versatile little plant here. And we climbed up this hill. That was very steep there. I think you can see, maybe get an idea of how steep that was. Coming up, it was like this at times, and we kept on climbing. Ultimately, we ended up over here. We're gonna go around here like this. It took us a while. This is just before we got probably to our highest point and started our way back down towards the fall, which you'll see here in a little while. But all these oaks here, these are the only oak that's native out there, Quercus campbellii, which you'd see them, they might get 10 to 15 feet tall, most of them much shorter than that. And does anybody know what this is? There's a leaf here, and which one? That's the glacier lily. It's drawn in this little pocket. It's a rock garden plant. And this is what everybody who was at lower elevations was seeing, was they were in seed, or they weren't in flower like we had seen the day before, or a couple days before. And just below that, you see, here's the trout lily, or the glacier lily, right up here. There was a heuchera, heuchera parvifolia, the little leaf elm root. Here's a close-up of the flowers there. So that one you think of more of as rock garden, to me anyways. A lot of the western heucheras, though, do not like us out here. We have to grow our southeastern ones, or hybrids with our southeastern heucheras to do well here. And, there's trout lilies, or glacier lilies in here, but the thing I wanted to show in here, anybody know what these are? Did you guys see any of those? You can see them in meadows, too. Those are pocket gopher tunnels from the winter. Whenever they were, this is on a rock, too. I don't know where the gophers got enough soil to do this, but you'd see the open soil areas, too, up like this. You'd see these tunnels in the woods, and it's from the pocket gophers during the winter. They're tunneling underneath the snow, and they push the soil up. I just thought that was kind of interesting. Yeah, but they had those instead of voles. But actually, I think they had voles, too. So I think we have it better that we don't have the pocket gophers. They've gone back down. We're starting back down that steep incline, but not so steep, because we actually met up with a more formal hiking path that was used by the public instead of just this one that roamed through the middle of nowhere. We started seeing some other plants again. This is Goodura pubescens, which we have our own rattlesnake plantains here in the east. And this is the species they have out there. Instead of a really netted leaf, these just have a white stripe down the middle. And these were just in bud. But I think the foliage on the Goodura are as pretty as anything. And this is a challenge to get a picture of. Mitella Staropetala, I'm going to say, the small-flowered mitrewort. We had seen a mitrewort in Michigan, or at least I had seen a mitrewort when we were in Michigan in 2015 in flower, and it was in a really wet spot. This was right along a dry path, but approaching the falls, but the flowers on these, you can actually see some. I got somewhat in focus. Very challenging to get a photo of, especially when you don't have a tripod and you're in a hurry. Tiny little flowers, as its name says, small flowers. And we get to the falls. There's a bridge that crosses right at the base of the falls. And we came from this side, and we went to this side, and we're going to go back up that way. Anyways, there were all kinds of people here getting their pictures taken. This was in a public area before we veered off the path again for the last little section of our hike.
Yeah,
I don't know how you get there. This is sheer rock here, if I remember. And I'm told that this had been even fuller and heavier just a few days beforehand from the snow melt. Because I think the week before we were there, they had actually got the 90s up there. And it melted a lot of the snow. Canactus douglasii, this was right on the rock face. I actually had seen this a couple times prior, and this next photo actually is from the day before, but kind of fitted in here a little better. I had a better picture of the plant from that day, or this day, than that. And here, this is a close-up of the flower. It's in the daisy family, no petals, just gray flower, or take that back, disc flowers. There's, I don't know, 15, 20 flowers right there. Cute little thing that you'd see in dry, sunny areas. And then, right along the path, they had probably a 5 or 6 foot wide asphalt pathway at this point. There was this little seat, and there was this beautiful clump of Coloriza maculata. This is a yellow form of it. What I showed you before was more the typical, more reddish form.
that we had seen multiple times, actually. And the next one, though, this Colorizus striata, this is a rare one out there, apparently. Found it in Caribou of one spot, right, actually, just about, 75 feet from the public restrooms that they had for this, up underneath a shrub, an overhanging shrub, right along the little path that was a hiking path, not the well-tread path that all the other people were using. But you had to get down, go under, and she said, look under here, you might be able to find one. And I managed to find the one, and everyone was taking a picture of it. So the flowers, unfortunately, were not facing the right direction. And we come up through a little wooded area, and we come out into the rock outcrop. When I showed you the pictures of us coming up that very steep incline, and I said, this spot over here is where we ended up, basically, this is in that general vicinity. This is the some of the Areognum umbellatum, which we would actually had seen this the whole time. I'd seen this coming up 131. We had seen this at Greenville Creek Mine as well. Did not see it at Dumont Lake, but very varied plant. These plants are probably only 6 to 12 inches tall. Well, this was growing in a different spot. Those are probably 24 inches tall. Very varied species. As its name is sulfur flower buckwheat, flowers can range from white to cream to yellow. They don't like it out here. Not many Areognums will grow here. A little west, they have an Areognum society. They're the crazy, crazy people. There's the Nargs people, they say, the Pentstemon people, and then there's the Areognum people. they go out on camping trips just to see this rare species of Areognum that only occurs in one spot. Anyways. This is another one. I don't think it was a rock garden plant. But this was coming up in a rock. This Mahonia repens, which you saw Mahonia repens actually very common out there throughout the whole western United States. Just gets maybe a foot or so tall, unlike the Mahonias that we grow here that are all pretty much all your Asian hybrids or selections now. But we do have a few American species in the garden. But this one, 6 to 12 inches tall, runs along the ground. But this one is running through the middle of a rock. And we're getting almost there. This Helianthella, this was probably actually mixed in a lot with the Wyathia at times that I had been showing you. A little bit different structure to it. The leaves on these are all along the stem and are much smaller than the Wyathia. And I see Helianthella and I think little sunflower. So one-flowered little sunflower, basically. And here's a close-up of the blossoms. And here's a really nice patch of it right here. Sagebrush in the background here. Here's some of the Areognum. Actually, it looks like there might be some clematis right in here. All kinds of stuff. This is just on those dry hillsides. Just the juxtaposition of the wets and dries out there is just so remarkable. And then our final plant, the Agastache urticifolia. Actually, again, I'd seen this one I think everywhere but Dumont Lake and Flower, but they were never open that much. This was much more open. I don't know if you can pick it out. There's actually a swallowtail butterfly here. There were two or three on this. They wouldn't stay in one place long enough for me to get a picture. They flutter about the time I almost get focused on them, so I gave up. But this was a really nice plant of it. Here, this was along one of the paths here, so you can see the close up of that. But this is one of the ones that smells like licorice, so. Oh wait, no, this one did smell of mint, not so much of licorice. This is more of a minty one. And I think that is my last photo of this specific plant. But again, we began with Wyathia, so I thought we'd end with another picture of Wyathia here. And you can actually see the ski slopes up here. Well, I hope you enjoyed that. Okay, are there any questions? You don't?
I know you told us already, but what was the date range and
the days that these pictures were taken were on the 24th, 25th, 26th of June.
Okay. The elevation range?
This one here, the range on this hike here was about 7,200 to 7,600. And the Greenville Mine one was about 7,600 to 8,500. And we were driving, but the elevation range roughly of the Dumont Lake area was about 95 to 9,600 feet.
You said a lot of the plants don't grow here. Is it because they're higher, or is it too humid? Or
too humid, and they aren't accustomed to heat. It was in the 70s when we were there. And they do occasionally get warmer than that, but not very often. The duration would kill them here. The nighttime temperatures, it was getting down into the 40s and low 50s when we were there. And even the last day we were there, the last morning we were there before we went back to Denver, there was frost. So they aren't accustomed to having nights in the 70s.
So if we're looking at the seeds for the exchange, we have to look, if it's Colorado, forget it?
Not necessarily. But like I said, the Heterotheca villosa, I think that would be very much worth a try here. For instance, I've seen it from, I've seen it in the desert, but I don't think it would have any issues. Part of it's our humidity also. There's just some things that you have, that don't work. Elephant head, I don't think we can grow here.
Just put it on the table.
Oh, we have Andy, you can just put it on the table. Any other questions?
That clematis you showed us with the tight bell.
Okay.
Is that creeping or bush?
No, that's a little shrub or sub-shrub. It's woody base, and they'll get about this big around there, about yay tall. Like I said, we have one over here. It's been two stems, and it's been there since 2006. So it will grow here, though.
Yeah.
Richard.
Find many insect activity? I'm thinking in terms of how the wild bee populations are distinct.
I don't remember. I didn't take note of it, but there were a lot of insects. I don't know. I don't remember the bees specifically.
The agastiki.
Yes, definitely. They had insects on them. That's for the swallowtails were in particular. Bigger things I did take more note of than some of the small things. Any others? Okay.
Thank you. Thank you.